Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Andrew Gron, the Assistant Director of the Center for International Studies, and it is my deep pleasure to welcome you to the inaugural event of our 50th anniversary series on Thinking Globally, International Studies, and the Global Turn in the Social Sciences. Recent approaches to globalization, climate change, and inequality have underscored the importance of critical knowledge on the processes and problems that interlink people and regions across the planet. Through its lectures and events, Thinking Globally explores the history, politics, and prospects of this global turn in the social sciences. Upcoming events will feature Karen Norsatina and Mary Puvi in conversation on global economic systems, Joe Masco and Trevor Paglin in conversation on global surveillance, Arjuna Padarai on the past and future of area studies, and Sonali Thakkar and Aranjana Khanna on post-coloniality and the global. For more information, please visit cis.uchicago.edu or follow us on Facebook or Twitter. We hope to see you as the series explores the genealogy and promise of global thought. Today, however, we are thrilled to welcome Professor Lynn Hunt to the University of Chicago. Lynn Hunt is Distinguished Research Professor and Eugen Weber Endowed Chair in Modern European History at the University of California at Los Angeles. She earned her BA from Carleton College and her MA and PhD from Stanford University. Before coming to UCLA, she taught at the University of Pennsylvania as well as the University of California at Berkeley. In an age when any scholar is lucky to make a single lasting impact on her or his area of research, Lynn Hunt has made many. A historian of the French Revolution, she has made field-defining contributions to European cultural history, the history of gender, the history of human rights, and historiography itself. Her books and publications are legion. Her research on the French Revolution resulted in Revolution in Urban Politics in Provincial France, Politics, Culture, and Class in the French Revolution, and the Family Romance of the French Revolution. Her writing on historical method and epistemology produced The New Cultural History. With Joyce Appleby and Margaret Jacob, she published Telling the Truth About History. With Jacques Revel, Histories, French Constructions of the Past. With Victoria Bonnell, Beyond the Cultural Turn. And more recently, Measuring Time, Making History. Her work on human rights led to Inventing Human Rights. In addition, she has edited collections on the history of eroticism and pornography, co-authored a Western Civilization textbook, The Making of the West, Peoples and Cultures, now in its fourth edition, and with Jack Sensor, co-authored a textbook on the French Revolution. I will let you all look up her articles, or we wouldn't make it out of here by the end of the night. Professor Hunt's most recent book is Writing History in the Global Era, published in 2013. An amazing review and argument on historical and cultural theory, it is an important intervention in the challenges and possibilities that globalization presents to the critical historical project. She has received numerous awards and fellowships, including a Distinguished Teaching Award of the Berkeley Division of the Academic Senate, University of California, a Guggenheim Fellowship, a Nancy Lehman Rolker Graduate Mentor Award from the American Historical Association, a Distinguished Teaching Award from UCLA, and in 2014, she was elected a corresponding fellow of the British Academy. In this distinguished CIS lecture, Professor Hunt will discuss thinking globally in historical studies, prospects, and problems. Just one quick note on the event format. After Professor Hunt's talk, there will be time for questions from the audience. We will have a microphone that we will do our best to pass around this specific room. It's always a little awkward and difficult since there's not a middle aisle, but it does ensure that everybody will be able to hear questions, and it also ensures that questions can be heard on the tape recording that's being made of the lecture. After the Q&A period, we will adjourn to the lobby just outside the doors at the back of this room, where wine and other refreshments await, and where the Seminary Co-op Bookstore will offer copies of Professor Hunt's books on sale. We encourage you all to join us for the reception and the book signing. But now, without further ado, please join me in welcoming Professor Lynn Hunt.
Well, thank you so much for coming out on a rather dreary evening. And I want to thank especially Andy Grahn for all the work he did in setting up this lecture, and especially since, and I appreciate especially his forbearance, because the poor man received an email from me yesterday saying, you know, I had to have emergency root canal on Monday, and I don't feel very well, and I hope I'm going to be able to come, but I just want you to know that right now it's not so great. Then later in the evening, I was able to send him something that said, things have calmed down. So I felt for him, because I know what it's like when you're the person organizing something for a long time, and the speaker says, oh, there's a potential problem, other than a snowstorm that might be arriving in Chicago the next day. And so I really want to thank him for putting up with all these difficulties of getting me here, and thanking you all for coming. My talk starts from the certainly contestable premise that the social and cultural theories that stimulated much history writing from the 1950s onward have lost their vitality, creating uncertainty about how history will be written in the future. At the same time, talk of globalization has proliferated. Is globalization the new paradigm that will reinvigorate history? Or will it choke off all other possible contenders, leaving in place only the inevitability of modernization of the world on the Western model? I do not have time today to do justice to my first assertion that the social and cultural theories that shaped the discipline of history from the 1950s onward have lost momentum. But I should perhaps make clear where I stand on this in a general way. First, there is probably considerable agreement that social history had a momentous impact on the study of history in the 1960s and 1970s, and that in the form of identity histories, the history of women, African Americans, Latinos, Asian Americans, gays, lesbians, and transsexuals, I mean to be inclusive here, not excluding of anyone else, it continues to exert considerable influence even today. Whether identity history represents a major shift from the original paradigm, and whether social history is going to see a revival, are both questions I leave to the discussion period, should you want to pursue them. When I say cultural theories have lost their vitality, I mean, in 30 seconds, by cultural theories, cultural history, the linguistic turn, cultural studies, postmodernism, poststructuralism, and even postcolonialism. I do not mean to say that these have disappeared or lost their validity as forms of critique and reevaluation. They are now presumably part of the graduate student canon in history. My talk today about thinking globally is meant to be relatively positive about the global turn, but also insistent about the need to retain the critical tools of those various cultural theoretical positions. And I am therefore dubious about versions of the global that proceed from perspectives that willingly or unintentionally obfuscate all that was learned from social and cultural approaches. Without venturing too much further into the rather desolate terrain of endless prolegomena, I need to warn you that I tend to use globalization as a shorthand for what should be a much more nuanced differentiation between globalization as a process, global and world history as subjects, and thinking globally as a perspective. I tend to be dubious about global and world history as subjects, interested in historicizing globalization as a process by giving it a longer history than is usual, and historicizing globalization as a concept, and entirely favorable to a global perspective, especially when it means pressing against the confines of nation-state-centered history. But in a final caveat, global tends to mean transnational when I am being favorable to a global perspective. Historians have only recently discovered globalization. Their neglect hardly makes them unique, however, as interest in globalization As shown by its increasing use in titles of books, dates only to the 1990s. This was extremely artisanal. I want a lot of credit for it. I had to go through WorldCat year by year, make an Excel sheet, and come up with this beautiful graph. All my other graphs required no work. The word hardly appears at all in titles before the late 1980s. But a sharp increase occurs during the 1990s and continues into the 2000s. A Google N-gram, which measures word frequency rather than titles, confirms this observation, as does a bookworm search. Even the much more ubiquitous adjective global does not yield a terribly different picture, except perhaps to signal the first bump from World War II. The only new technology that emerged in the 1990s was the spread of the internet. But at the time, it affected mainly the already developed world. In 2000, only 5% of the world's population used the internet, as compared to 45% in 2015. The internet continues to penetrate and link different regions of the world and is certainly a force in globalization, but the rapid spread that began in 2000 cannot explain the quickening interest in globalization at the beginning of the 1990s. Yes, of course, we could argue about this, and I would certainly be interested in your views. It could be that the interest in globalization is entirely Western, and therefore the growth of the internet in the 1990s would be significant, even though that growth only occurs at the very end of the 1990s. This is a slide of US internet connection as of 2000, and data was only collected on internet access as opposed to owning a computer from 1997. You see that the growth was really incredibly fast at the very end of the decade. Globalization did not suddenly attract attention in the 1990s because it only started then or took a fundamentally different shape at that moment. What did happen was the collapse of the Soviet Union and the end of the Cold War. Globalization, this is my hypothesis, filled the ideological vacuum created by the end of the Cold War division between capitalism and communism. Now, this is a Google N-gram which I find suggestive. It proves nothing, but I think it leads to some interesting possible speculations. It's of Marxism, as you see, communism and globalization, and one of the things I want to show is that interest in globalization is, in a sense, coming up as interest in communism and Marxism. It's not declining exactly, but it's also not exactly increasing. The world order became uncertain as the Soviet Union broke up, and communism ceased to be a vital issue. Globalization appeared to be the one sure thing. Many argued, moreover, that globalization explained the fall of the Soviet Union. Its state-directed industries could not compete in the electronic global economy that emerged in the 1980s. Historians had their own reasons for ignoring globalization until recently, chief among them the straitjacket of nation-centered history. This is said, by the way, as somebody who has always worked on France between about 1787 and 1793, with occasional forays in other directions. So this is not at all, this is a self-critique. It is not a critique of others. In the United States, 39% of history faculty in the colleges and universities teach US history. The next biggest category, European history, accounts for just over one-fourth. The figures for national history in France, the United Kingdom, and Germany are even higher, reaching in the German case to nearly half. The obsession with one's own nation is not limited to Western Europe and the United States. The history faculty at Beijing University seems to be less oriented toward national history than, for example, the University of Delhi, but still over half of its faculty specializes in Chinese history. In the School of History at Australian National University, two-thirds of the faculty work on Australian history. Specialization at the university level cemented the bond between professional historians and the national histories they studied, even for those, like myself, who did not devote themselves to their own national history. An Australian historian might study the Italian Renaissance, for example, but would find it difficult to master, in addition, Francis I's reign in France, much less the Spanish and Portuguese conquest of the Americas, even though these events happened at the same time. Specialization followed from the drive of history and other social science and humanities fields to emulate science. To be an expert meant mastering a field of study, picking a pertinent problem to examine, undertaking research on it, and publishing the findings. A kind of vicious circle ensued. Publications increased as universities demanded proof of expertise. And as the volume of publications surged, fields had to be defined ever more narrowly if they were to be mastered. A historian might start off, as I did, as an historian of France, and quickly narrow the focus to one region in France, one or two towns, or even one village. For my PhD dissertation and first book, I examined two towns in the region of Champagne, Reims and Troyes, at the end of the old regime and the beginning of the French Revolution, 1786 to 1790, more or less. The aim of such studies was always to illuminate the history of one country. An analysis of two countries, therefore, seemed wildly ambitious. If most people were talking about one or two places in one country, how could a historian talk about two countries with different languages, cultures, and histories? Although historians specializing in pre-1800 time periods might focus on a single Renaissance city-state like Florence, or even an entire empire, such as the Roman, Ottoman, or Holy Roman ones, the nation-state has dominated historical research about the modern period. There are few historians of Europe in the modern period, just historians of France, Great Britain, Italy, etc. Virtually no Asian historians, just specialists on Japan, China, India, Indonesia, etc. No historians of the Americas, but rather historians of Canada, the United States, Mexico, or Peru. Historians of Africa sometimes work on more than one former colony, but usually only other colonies of the same imperial power. Yet even nation-centered history writing has begun to stretch under the impact of changes in national identities. Since students in the United States now come from all over the world, for example, learning about the world is an important supplemental way of creating, perhaps paradoxically, national coherence. World history of some kind has been taught in US high schools since their first establishment in the early 19th century. But as my slide shows, world history seems to have come into vogue with World War I and especially World War II. Until the 1980s, however, world history generally meant the history of Western civilization. Popular textbooks of the late 19th century either failed to say anything about India or China, for example, or mentioned them only in passing while concentrating on ancient Greece and Rome and the history of Europe. The establishment of a World History Association in 1982 marked the moment at which world history began to move away from a Eurocentric focus to a more polycentric one. In its teaching guide for the advanced placement examination in world history that is administered to high school students planning to attend a college or university, the College Board explicitly cites the growing number of US students from non-European backgrounds and their desires for, quote, history teaching that touches on their own cultural origins as well as on the long privileged European past, end quote. In contrast to the United States, European nations have to confront not only the challenges of incorporating new immigrants into the national narrative, but also those of constructing a European identity as something intermediary between the nation state and the world. In the late 1990s, Recommendation 1283 of the Parliamentary Assembly of the Council of Europe called upon schools in the European Union to include in their syllabuses, quote, the history of the whole of Europe, that of the main political and economic events, and the philosophical and cultural movements that have formed the European identity, end quote. Still, world history is on the rise in Europe too. The areas announced for the French Agrégation in History, which gives you a teaching post, in 2013 were the following: the Greek diasporas in the Mediterranean basin and the Indus Valley from 800 to 300 BC, war and society 1270 to 1480 in Scotland, England, Ireland, Wales, France, and the western regions of the Holy Roman Empire, international circulation in Europe 1680 to 1780, and colonial societies in Africa, the Caribbean, and Asia 1850s to 1950s. We should be only so happy if all of our undergraduates knew all of these subjects. Even if these topics still give priority to Europe, they represent a considerable broadening out from a narrow national base. Although the reasons for historians' increasing interest in global history are still up for discussion, a major shift is definitely underway. Interest in transnational, if not global, history is rapidly increasing. Historians of 18th century and revolutionary France, for example, now recognize the influence of slavery, not just on the Caribbean islands and the African trading posts where slaves were bought and transported by French merchants, but also on mainland France itself. Since French territories stretch across the world from Martinique in the Caribbean and Saint-Pierre in Canada to New Caledonia in the Pacific, it seems only right to stop limiting French history to its European implantation. Moreover, even European France can no longer be viewed as self-evidently French. French cafes, for example, were first set up in 17th century Paris by Armenian merchants, and many of the French did not speak French until late in the 19th century. A global history was always lurking behind the veneer that nationalism painted on the past. So is globalization a new paradigm, or is it a Trojan horse that threatens to bring back old paradigms rather than truly offering a new one? Do we risk losing all that we gained from the challenges that cultural history and the histories of race, class, and gender posed to the old paradigms? Or can cultural theories offer a critical perspective that helps reshape the globalization debates themselves? To answer these questions, we first need a definition. Globalization is the process by which the world becomes more interconnected and more interdependent. The emphasis on interdependence is critical because it means simple contact is not sufficient. Globalization did not occur the moment when Christopher Columbus set foot on an island in the Bahamas in 1492. Globalization only occurred when Europeans developed a taste or use for plants that grew in the Americas, tomatoes, potatoes, corn, chocolate, tobacco, or could be grown there, sugar and cotton, with the development of plantation slavery. In other words, globalization increased when Europe and the Americas, to take that example, became dependent on each other, even if their interdependence was far from mutual or equally beneficial. Although globalization, in my view, is best viewed as a long-term process, running in fits and starts throughout all of human history, most commentators on globalization have focused on the last 20 to 30 years, whether their emphasis has been on economic, technological, social, political, cultural, or biological forms of globalization. As a description of the world we live in, the term globalization can be useful in highlighting common processes. Problems arise, however, when the term stands for a paradigm or overarching account of historical change. It does not always signify a paradigm, and even those who use the term do not agree on the overarching account. Indeed, much of the current debate concerns the bottom line: is globalization good or bad? If it is deemed to be good, then the narrative is very different from when it is viewed as negative in its effects. Whether they think globalization is good for humanity or bad, however, proponents and critics of globalization can argue on this issue because they agree that there is a distinct process taking place and that its causes are in the first instance economic. The globalization of capital, especially of finance. Arjuna Paderai, whom Andrew mentioned is coming later this quarter or later this year, one of the leading cultural theorists of globalization, repeats the contemporary common wisdom when he writes, quote, "Globalization is inextricably linked to the current workings of capital on a global basis. Its most striking feature is the runaway quality of global finance," end quote. According to this line of argument, capital markets, and with them financial speculation, are no longer constrained by national borders or even by industrial productivity. Since global capital is not fixed anywhere, it is deterritorializing in its impact. Transactions no longer take place in a particular place. This deterritorialization, which as you can see follows quite closely on the heels of globalization, which some consider as defining of globalization, challenges purportedly the sovereignty of nation states, which are, after all, built upon a notion of control over territory, over a defined piece of land. Whether deterritorialization is the key feature of globalization or not, both the arguments for and against globalization consider the political, social, cultural, and even technological forms of globalization to be secondary or derivative from the primary factor of a globalizing economy. Globalization as a paradigm, therefore, in my view, asserts the inescapability of the process, the primacy of economics in driving it, and the desirability of research focused on economic factors. The research of the few historically oriented scholars who have tried to analyze globalization as a whole reflects this development. The prime examples are Fernand Braudel's Total History, Emmanuel Wallerstein's World Systems, and André Gunder Frank's attempt to reorient thinking about globalization to pay greater attention to Asia, especially China. I only have time here to give a couple of choice quotes to make this point, one of several sweeping statements that I am just throwing out, which you will have to take up with me in the discussion period. At the end of the first volume of his three-volume Global History of Capitalism, Braudel casts capitalism as a unique actor. Quote, "Capitalism could choose the areas where it wished and was able to intervene, and the areas it would leave to their fate, rebuilding as it went its own structures from these components, and gradually in the process transforming the structures of others," unquote. In 2004, Wallerstein explained the connection of his world systems analysis to globalization. Quoting him, "The proponents of world systems analysis have been talking about globalization since long before the term was invented. Not, however, as something new, but as something that has been basic to the modern world system ever since it began in the 16th century," unquote. The modern world system, he insisted, quote, "is and always has been a world economy. It is and always has been a capitalist world economy," end quote. Finally, Frank argued that the world system went back much further in time to the spread of agriculture and writing around 4000 BC. He insisted that virtually all the previous attempts to compare the West and the Orient from Marx and Weber to Braudel and Wallerstein had been blinded by Eurocentrism. The title of his book, Reorient, made clear his intentions in this regard. But it is the subtitle of his book, Global Economy in the Asian Age, that is most relevant to my purposes. Like Braudel and Wallerstein, Frank gives priority to economics. With its emphasis on the driving force of economic change, globalization as a paradigm has been as omnivorous as globalization is purported to be as a process. It gobbles up everything in its path. In this respect, the positions of Braudel, Wallerstein, and Frank, whatever the differences in interpretation between them, typify the globalization paradigm more generally. Globalization has incorporated two of the previously dominant paradigms in history, modernization and Marxism, and dramatically altered another, the paradigm of identity politics. Globalization for many is the new name for modernization. And Marxists now devote their attention to criticizing it as such, rather than to developing an alternative. In the globalization paradigm, identity no longer derives from a fixed social category, such as ethnicity, or from a cultural construction, such as race. Globalization creates hybrid identities that burst the confines of the previous definitions and transform the conditions of identity politics. More than two decades ago, Arjun Upadhyay called attention to the development of what he called global ethnoscapes. The global movement of people he predicted would create new, previously unimagined forms of identity. Tourists, refugees, guest workers, immigrants, and exiles would no longer be the exception to the rules of social identity. He might well have cited migratory professors too, since he was one of them. These changes would require new kinds of ethnography, a transnational anthropology, according to Upadhyay, that could capture the new forms of fluid hybrid identities that cross traditional borders. Sociologists now analyze transnational identity politics, an effect created when, as one of them explains, globalization hybridizes, particularizes, and postmodernizes culture and politics. Of course, given recent events, one might question how far this is actually really true. The absorption of many of the previous paradigms of historical research into one overarching globalization paradigm has two potentially troubling consequences. It shifts attention to macro-historical, that is worldwide, and especially macroeconomic trends, and it ensconces the assumption that economics shapes all other aspects of life. To make this point, I once again use a suggestive chart, which I'm not sure that you can actually see, of co-locates of globalization in English language web pages around the world. We could do some interesting things with this, especially about national differences. Up at the top, all those two letter abbreviations are countries. IN is India, HK is Hong Kong. But my main point is that economic is at the top of the list. The list reads economic, process, era, impact, globalization, technology, trade, economy. So the collocates of globalization are overwhelmingly about the economy. Much depends, however, on how globalization is studied, in particular whether it is approached from the top down or from the bottom up. Viewed from the top down, globalization is a process that transforms every part of the globe, creating a world system in Wallerstein's terms. Viewed from the bottom up, it is more likely to be seen as a series of transnational processes in which the histories of diverse places become connected and interdependent. The shift in perspective does not lead to similar final results. On the contrary, the different perspectives, top down, bottom up, yield divergent understandings of what globalization has been and is as a process. The top-down perspective is that of world or global history. If the goal of historicizing globalization is, as world historian Jerry Bentley said, to focus on, to quote him, large-scale processes that connect the world's many ostensibly distinct and discrete societies, unquote, then the international patterns of the exchange of goods and peoples almost inevitably takes pride of place. If trade or commercial exchange is not foregrounded, then the movements of peoples and diseases are instead. The top-down perspective on globalization seems destined to draw historians' attention to macro-historical or systemic processes. The importance assigned to worldwide processes, and especially economics, derives to some extent from the availability or lack of availability of data. It is much easier to develop quantitative indices of flows of goods and people than it is to trace the circulation of ideas or practices. To take just one of countless examples that might be offered, a recent ambitious attempt to determine the influence of globalization on national systems of innovation in Asia and Europe begins by defining innovation in these terms, quote, new creations of economic significance primarily carried out by firms, end quote. The human development indicators used for the study based on contemporary data are per capita GDP and life expectancy. It is easier to compare per capita income, for example, than it is to measure opportunities for personal development that take other non-economic forms. For earlier periods, economic indicators may be the only quantitative ones that are readily available. Just by virtue of enlarging the scale, then, the globalization paradigm favors economic and other structural explanations. In fact, however, the bottom-up perspective is much more common among historians, if only because historical expertise depends on in-depth knowledge. I am leaving to the side the whole category of mid-range studies, such as Bailey's History of the Modern World, 1780 to 1914, but we can return to them later if you like. Most global history is, in fact, transnational or comparative, rather than truly global. Brodel, Wallerstein, and Franck have produced few emulators among historians. Brodel's three volumes on capitalism sought the economic origins of the modern world within Europe and offered richly descriptive material about ordinary life, but no general thesis about globalization. Wallerstein and Franck put forth grand synthetic theories about the history of globalization, but carried out no original research. The bottom-up perspective offers its own kind of middle ground, seeking new evidence from which to build new generalizations rather than to test overarching theoretical models. Looking from the bottom up at globalization can accommodate various angles of vision as long as they cross over national boundaries. By deliberately looking across national boundaries, historians have rediscovered long neglected transnational spaces such as borderlands, deserts, rivers, and oceans. When Brodel wrote famously about the Mediterranean, he focused almost exclusively on the littoral, on the land around it. He wanted readers to grasp the interconnections between the peoples living on the shores of the Mediterranean and its hinterland. The new oceanic approach reminds us that history is not just about landed territory, but also about the bodies of water themselves. The more seas and oceans are emphasized, the less the nation state as a landed territory seems the inevitable point of departure. The American Historical Review published four reviews of books in which ocean figured in the title between 1990 and 1999, but no articles. Between 2000 and 2009, it published 17 such book reviews and 5 articles on the subject. It's not exactly a huge trend, but it is a trend. Looking from the bottom up requires few prior assumptions. The historian need not presume, for example, that globalization is or always has been driven by economics. In an exemplary study of tobacco and chocolate in the Atlantic world, Marcy Norton shows how the Spanish learned to use tobacco and chocolate in the Americas from nursemaids, concubines, Indian healers, and market vendors. Returning colonists and sailors brought tobacco and chocolate back to Spain, but the commerce in those goods only took off at the end of the 16th century, a century after Columbus's maiden voyage. The first big shipments of chocolate were ordered by elite merchants and Catholic clergy who had themselves spent time in the Americas. The story of tobacco is even more complex because many European governments tried to regulate and even monopolize it. Once plantation cultivation of tobacco spread throughout the Caribbean, smugglers, privateers, and shippers of all the European Atlantic nations competed furiously for the crops, establishing a taste for tobacco almost simultaneously in those nations. Before long, tobacco use spread as well to the Middle East, Africa, India, China, and Japan. Tobacco and chocolate spread to Europe through a process of cultural syncretism. The increase in commerce did not follow immediately from conquest. It was made possible by changes in taste. And those changes took place under the influence of indigenous people, and in the case of chocolate, indigenous women in particular. The significance of these findings goes far beyond the world of early modern chocolate and tobacco. For as Norton maintains, chocolate paved the way for coffee, and the two, along with tea, created a demand for sugar, for porcelain chocolate pots, and imitation Chinese teacups, and the like. With sugar came plantations and slavery. To buy slaves, Europeans needed Indian textiles and cowrie shells from the Maldives, because these were the products preferred by African traders. I myself had a major obsession with cowries for at least a year, a couple of years back, because this strikes me as one of the great unrecognized important stories about globalization, the fact that these cowries had to come from the Maldives because the Arab traders in Africa preferred them, and also local Africans, and this led to an incredible, as you see from the map, inter-regional trade in these shells, with ships carrying literally tons of cowries all the way back first to Europe, and then put back onto the ships that were going to get slaves and sent down to the slave coast where they were used to buy slaves. They accounted for between a third and a half of the price of slaves in English and French slave and Dutch slave trading. But I can't go on about that because we have to move along. In sum, the taste for chocolate and tobacco that developed in individual Spanish households in the Americas in the 16th century helped set in motion one of the most powerful early waves of globalization. Yes, the wave brought with it enormous economic changes, but its force can only be comprehended by paying attention to local cultural patterns and their changes over time. That is, by studying gender and race relations between conquerors and conquered peoples, class distinctions within Spanish and other European societies, and the ways people experienced changing tastes. The bottom-up perspective has proved particularly fruitful in studying globalization in the early modern period, that is, between 1500 and 1800. Improvements in shipbuilding and navigation enabled Europeans to travel across the globe, make contact with far-flung peoples, and establish various kinds of enduring links with them, often using brute military force and continuing coercion. Yet even while trade and military conflict took on global dimensions, communication across vast distances required considerable time, often several months. Correspondence and manuscript newsletters proved essential conduits of information about prices, commercial contacts, and currency exchange rates, and have therefore provided invaluable historical evidence about the way globalization worked. The relatively low intensity of globalization in the early modern period makes it particularly amenable to study. Imagine trying to make sense of the billions of emails exchanged in global commerce in recent years, assuming that an investigator could be certain that emails and not telephone calls or meetings in airport conference rooms were the crucial means of interaction in present-day globalization. No such uncertainty attaches to the exchange of letters in the early modern period. If I had more time, I would discuss in some detail the landmark studies of Francesca Trivolato and Cebu Eslanian. Trivolato used the 13,000 letters exchanged by a Sephardic Jewish family firm operating out of Livorno, Italy, and ranging as far as India. And Eslanian uncovered the courier system of Julfan Armenians that enabled them to trade in the Indian Ocean, the Mediterranean, Northwestern Europe, and Russia. Diasporic communities such as the Jews and Armenians, but also South Asians, Chinese, and Africans, not to mention Scots, have attracted particular interest because they carried and often still carry globalization in their baggage. They traveled, established new connections that they wove together with their old ones, and built globalization from the ground up, one letter, one sale, one relationship at a time. This bottom-up perspective makes it possible to revise the globalization paradigm in fundamental ways. Economic motivation need no longer be considered inherently primary, and even in the many instances where trade is the goal, and trade has been the easiest to study so far, It is clear that other factors, changing tastes, personal interactions, family ties, literacy, religious sensibilities, make global economic transactions possible. Moreover, the nation-state is not necessarily the relevant unit of comparison, an assumption often made only because most economic statistics were gathered by states in the modern period. It is not accidental that some of the most compelling historical studies of globalization have focused either on specific commodities, such as chocolate, tobacco, diamonds, textiles, or ostrich plumes, or on particular ethnic networks, such as Jews, Armenians, or South Asians. Only by tracing commodities or networks, the things exchanged and the people who exchange them, can the workings of globalization be truly understood. If deterritorialization is associated with globalization, then it is because things and people cross borders, not just going from one well-defined place to another, as in moving from one country to another, but also creating new kinds of interstitial spaces, such as caravans, trade convoys, the haunts of pirates and smugglers, slave markets, and banks. There would have been no currency exchange, no letters of credit, or any other instruments of international interaction if people who could use them did not invent them. And not surprisingly, Trivolato and Islanian are both separately now working on bills of exchange. In short, deterritorialization and globalization do not happen willy-nilly through the operation of invisible institutions or processes. They occur because people act and interact. This kind of bottom-up study effectively counters the notion that globalization is another name for modernization, that is, for the homogenization of the world through the circulation, absorption, and imposition of Western values. Globalization grew from a multitude of sources in the early modern period and beyond. Hindu merchants who traded in Iran, Afghanistan, and Russian Central Asia. Armenians who traded in India, China, the Philippines, Russia, the Mediterranean, including the Ottoman Empire, and Northwestern Europe. Muslims who plied the trans-Saharan route with gold, salt, leather, slaves, and manuscript books, as well as their religion. The many peoples who worked one segment or another of the Central Asian caravan routes, and merchants passing Indian textiles through various hands to Africa and Europe, just to mention some of the examples from the early modern period. The West did not globalize the world on its own. Adventurous and enterprising people across the world brought their various locales into greater interconnection and interdependence. Since globalization is not, therefore, a uniquely Western creation, the globalization paradigm must be modified to take account of these multiple origins and processes. Globalization is not the same thing as modernization. As Sanjay Subramaniam argues, quote, we must abandon the developmental perspective that comes down to us with two fathers, Marx and W.W. Rostow, and which believes that the only question worth asking is that of who succeeded and who failed on the long road to modern industrial capitalism from a list of modern nation states, unquote. Non-Western histories and scholars are crucial to understanding the jointly constructed process of globalization. With this bottom-up, more truly global perspective, it is possible to counter some of the false assumptions of the globalization debates. Just as globalization is not the same thing as Westernization, so too the globalization of historical research need not mean that Eurocentric models of development will necessarily dominate. Modern science and the modern historical discipline may have taken root first in the West, but science and history are not Western in essence. Western geopolitical dominance has translated into Western dominance of science and, to some extent, history. But as the relations of power change, science and history will change too. In a study of global knowledge production in the 21st century, the British Royal Society found that between the periods 1999-2003 and 2004-2008, at the tiniest possible slices of time, the share of the US authorship of global publications dropped from the admittedly high level of 26% to 21%, while that of China rose from 4% to 10%, elevating China from sixth to second place over Japan, Great Britain, Germany, and France. The extent of change in such a short time frame is extraordinary, and augurs similar, if not greater, changes in the future. In the past, Western historians and social theorists did often use Europe as their touchstone for development, making invidious comparisons to non-Western cultures. They failed to appreciate until very recently, for example, the many varieties of history writing that could be found in non-Western cultures. This is precisely what the new research on early modern globalization succeeds in doing, showing how people living outside of Europe or in the interstices of European commerce, such as the Jews, have together created globalization on a worldwide canvas. Much research remains to be done from a cultural theory perspective on the emergence of globalization as a category of analysis. Why did globalization become a common term after the collapse of the Soviet Union? And why have so many assumed that globalization is first and foremost about deterritorialized capitalist markets? In answering such contemporary questions, the longer-term view of globalization is bound to be fruitful. Remarkable work has already been done on the early modern sources of globalization, but more remains to be done on this and on the cultural forms of globalization, which are much harder to study, from the spread of religions to the diffusion of nationalism as an ideology. With this kind of bottom-up approach, globalization can become a fruitful paradigm for historical research, one that offers truly new perspectives rather than recycling of past ones. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that talk. I wanted to just, if I understood you correctly, you're arguing against the abandonment of social and cultural historical frameworks in understanding the newly in as we expand and develop a more global perspective on historical developments. And I wanted to ask you then, what led you to make your assertion very early on in your talk that social and cultural theories have lost their vitality, if not their relevance? Wondered just if you could elaborate on the ways you see them being eclipsed and what specific trends you want to push against.
Yeah. I said they have lost their vitality. I don't think I said they lost their relevance. I think it's more that I see them as having lost a certain momentum. That is, I think social history was an incredibly important intellectual force in the 1950s and the 1960s, originally first associated with recovering the history of the working class and the history of African Americans. And then later, various other groups like women, and there's a whole long list, we don't need to go into that right now. In the 1970s and 1980s, there's the rise of various forms of cultural history, cultural theories, which have had influence, I think, carrying on into the 21st century. I don't want to say it has lost all influence, but I don't think it has the same, it's not the same, if only the people just are no longer fighting about it in the way that they were fighting about it in the 1980s and 1990s. So it's no longer the center of the conversation in the same way. And I see interest in global history, globalization, as taking up a certain amount of that sense of vitality and momentum. And I think for people who are teaching graduate students or who have PhD students, this is incontrovertible. The job advertisements now frequently say, not what they said in my day, history of France, but you have to be able to do France and the colonies at the very least, if not some other place as well. So the advertisements show a much greater interest. I think it's not just to cut down on the number of faculty by having people do more work, but a sort of growing sense that we need to talk about interconnection more. And that's what's behind what I'm talking about. I'm just trying to figure out, well, why was that happening and what is that about? I think the fuller story would be partly about how I think there were some problems with cultural theories and how they developed over time, but I don't think they've lost their relevance. What I'm trying to argue is that they need to be used in this kind of framework to critique certain elements of the interest in globalization, and also I think have been concretely used by historians in ways that have been extremely productive in showing that globalization works in much more complicated ways than is assumed by those who take only a top-down perspective. So it's not that I want to say that it's being displaced. I'm saying I think it has an extremely important role to play, both in the way globalization is studied, but also, as I was trying to suggest, we need to have more analysis of why has globalization become such an interest? Is it truly that the world became suddenly much, much more interconnected? I tried to argue that there must be sort of political reasons for this, but I suspect there are much more complicated reasons as well. And many people are working on this, but I do see an important role for cultural theory in that kind of sort of deconstruction of the concept and what it means. So that's a really important question. So thank you for asking it.
Yeah, you mentioned the rise of the new oceanic histories or the quote-unquote new thesology. And my understanding of those is that they're usually tied to broader regional studies like Atlantic history or Pacific history or Indian Ocean history. And so I'm just curious as to the relationship between those broader regional histories and the global and whether they cancel each other out or they're compatible in some ways.
That's a really interesting question. And, you know, somebody who works on a few years of the French Revolution is probably not in the best possible place to be propounding theses on these important questions, but here I am, so I will do it anyway. I think that's actually one of the virtues, actually, of having people coming out of the cultural theory perspective is to ask different kinds of questions. And one of the things that strikes me, and I have said this, actually, to Francesca and Cebu, whose books I admire enormously, is that these people need to talk to each other more. They have to talk to each other more about what is the relationship between these different networks, to talk about the ones that I talked about, but to return to what you're talking about. Yes, they have been done very much in this regional context. But there's an interesting issue here because I think, for example, there was a huge interest in Atlantic history amongst US historians and also in British historians. That became a big field, Atlantic history. It wasn't so much for French historians, for, I suspect, political and cultural reasons. But that's, in a sense, been some of those people feel threatened, actually, by the rise of the interest in a more kind of global perspective. So there's a lot of jockeying around about this subject, but what I think is really interesting is that there's a lot of, because of the change of perspective, has produced new important research. One of the things we need now is for some people to step back a little and say, well, how does it fit together? And what is, without saying it fits together because there's a world system that fits it all together. I mean, maybe you would end up saying that if you want to. I'm not saying you can't, but people would get together and say, well, what does this mean about the articulation of regions and how it works? As somebody who has worked on France, one of the things that struck me when I got interested in the Caribbean and slavery and its relationship to French history was that it isn't an Atlantic story. I'm sorry, the whole question about the slave trade is not an Atlantic story. That's why I showed that picture about the cowries. There is no slave trade without Indian textiles and the cowries from the Maldives. The idea that it's an Atlantic system is absurd because it's a system that involves an interlocking set of regional, broad interregional relationships. But this is great. I mean, these are the kinds of things that we didn't think that much about before because we weren't thinking about, well, how did those things fit together? So this is a really important question, and I think people are going to be arguing about it for a long time to come. And this is not at all a critique of people who only study the Indian Ocean or the Pacific Ocean or the Atlantic Ocean. These are huge, difficult topics, and I certainly don't mean to be critical at all. I'm just saying I think there's a role for some talk about how these things, how we envision them as fitting together. But right now is a really exciting moment that people are doing things that no one thought of doing before. You know, the Jeffrey Bolster's book on the Atlantic Ocean and the people who worked on the ocean, it gives you a completely different perspective on problems than we used to have. So I'm totally in favor of that.
Yeah. I have a question similar to the one that was just asked. I hear in your presentation a conflation two global things. The emergence of worldwide globalization economically, politically, and so forth, on the one hand, and on the other, the emergence of global history. And I think that you discussed them both concurrently. And I have the impression that the globalization of the world started a long time ago, before people started doing global history. And I want to understand to what extent actual globalization, economic, political, and so forth, has prompted historians like yourself to do global history as an account of the world, an account of how the world is evolving.
Well, my own view is that the entire history of the human race has actually been about globalization. Not that everything in that history has been about globalization, but that the original, what we now think of as the move out of Africa many hundreds of thousands of years ago is already a first step in globalization. So the idea that globalization is recent, I think, is deeply problematic. So what I'm interested is the gap between what seems to me to be a very long history with different moments of intensity, different moments of pulling back, and this very short term, what I tried to document is this very recent interest in globalization. So I'm interested in why we weren't interested in globalization when arguably globalization has always been happening. And that's why I talked so much about nation-centered history writing, because I think there's a way in which the rise of nationalism, which is another form of globalization, in the 19th century and its association with the rise of history as an academic discipline gave a certain cast to historical thinking that produced all kinds of great things, but that also had, it turns out, had its limitations. It was in some ways a very blinkered vision of the way history operated. And right now we're in a period where I think there are questions being raised about the time frame that historians should be talking about, whether we should be talking about deep history, about the spatial extent at which historians should be. I think these are all great questions. I don't think we know exactly how that's all going to shake out in the end. I just think there's no question that we're now interested in that. And so one of my sort of ideological interests or cultural interests is why now, when this is arguably been happening for a long time. So that's one question, and then there are all kinds of empirical questions about, well, how does globalization work historically? I think that we're going to see much more in the way of cultural studies of globalization in the future. For example, as I said, about religion, about nationalism. These are much harder to do, but I think are going to be extremely important. One of my problems in giving this talk is that I want to argue against the primacy of economics, and yet all the work that's been done that's really, really interesting so far has been on commodities and on trading networks, because that's where there has been the best data available about this. So I'm kind of stuck here, because what I really want is things that are done differently, but I'm certainly not criticizing people like Marcy Norton, Francesca Trivolato, or Sabu Islanian, because these young scholars have taken on extraordinarily difficult topics spanning continents, and in the case especially of Sabu Islanian, requiring unbelievable linguistic competencies. I mean, 17th century Julfan Armenian is a very different language from modern Armenian. And these people were trading everywhere. Since I know him, I know he has, one minute he's in Cairo, the next he's in Florence, and he's just going all over the globe because the Armenians went all over the globe. And this is not the kind of thing that most of us grew up 40 years ago when we were in training as historians. We were not thinking about going to 15 different places around the world to do our work. We were thinking about learning about one culture really well. I'm not saying that that's bad. I still do it. I love it. And I think it had incredibly important effects, but we're in a period, I think, of a kind of ferment about the different ways that people could be approaching subjects.
May I make a follow-up comment?
Yes, sure.
Okay, here is something very interesting, the illustration that you concluded your talk with. So it shows an important shift in the global involvement of different nations and the emergence of China in particular in second position, whereas it was in a lower position on the left side. So in terms of global history, what is the explanation? Because we see here a reconfiguration of global interdependencies, global competition, but what I didn't get is a global account of why things happen this way. I could choose another example. Why did Europeans colonize Africa at the time when they did and not sooner? Or another example, why did the French support the American Revolution? Is it because they like Americans or because they hated the Britons? Or is there a longer history behind that which in a global approach can shed light to such events?
Well, these are, your two examples are actually very, 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 very different, because the question of why the French supported the Americans, you can actually go to archives and find documents that would support an argument one way or another. I don't think it's possible to make a definitive argument about why Europeans colonized Africa at an exact moment. This is the kind of, it's a very interesting question, and people will certainly write about it, but I think it would be hard to find a document or set of documents that would definitively prove one way or another why it was at one time as opposed to another. So one thing that's interesting about the rise of interest in these global questions is that they raise questions, and some of those questions we can answer, and that's the work I've talked about here. And some of them are actually quite difficult to answer. For example, why did people become interested in globalization in the 1990s? Lots of people have lots of theories about that, because it would be hard to find a set of documents that would be convincing on the subject of why that was true. I can show you endless Google n-grams, but they are not probative. They will not nail down the argument. They only suggest further questions to be asked. So I think that it will always be the case that there will be some big questions, which I think are worth asking, that we will continue to argue about, and other things that we can actually learn distinct, concrete things about, like why chocolate spread from the New World to Spain in the 16th century. I think Marcy Norton has developed an argument that really has an empirical basis about how that worked. But other than that, I'm afraid I'm probably not answering your question in quite the way that you would like, but that's the best I can do. Leora. You noticed how many times I mentioned taste.
I did. it seems implicit in your answer to one of these questions, where when you're talking about the connection of history written in the nation state and for the nation state, that there's a political narrative around the move to historians' interest in the global, which is rather than an economic one, which is rather than an argument that, which you say doesn't work empirically in certain ways, that global history follows economic globalization, that it is that a sense in the 1990s of the decline of the relevance of the nation state politically might and a detachment of the historian's work from the work of nation making would be part of what drives that move. And then that poses interesting questions about who's going to support the history being written, that once it gets detached from the nation state structure. You talked about the aggregation and its role in forming French teachers, who are, of course, French teachers who are serving the French nation state, paid for by it. And so with the end of the Cold War that you cite, and also the development of the European Union and the denationalization of education and scholarly production in Europe, is one kind of logic for the detachment of history from the nation. But I think we don't know what kind of, who the patrons are gonna be for a global history when it isn't clear, when what it's serving is this these transnational structures. And that's a particular issue perhaps in the United States, which remains a deeply national structure as opposed to Europe, which has moved elsewhere.
I think you're actually asking a whole series of questions as opposed to one question, and they are all incredibly important questions. But there are two in particular I would draw attention to. The first falls in that category of things that we will argue about that will not be able to be definitively resolved on the basis of empirical evidence, and that is whether the interest in the rise of, as I understood what you were saying, whether the interest of the rise in, of interest in globalization and things global is a result of certain economic changes that took place in the structure of capital in the 1990s and the 2000s. And then you were, it seemed to me, implicitly linking that then to the detachment from nation-state-centered history as part of a nation-building project in which historians were deeply implicated, which I take to be the second question. One could see them as either totally linked to each other or not totally linked to each other. I'm not sure what I think about this entirely, except that I don't think it just follows from changes in capital markets. I think much more attention needs to be paid to this question of, exactly as you put it, history started as a nation-building project, is still a nation-building. One of the things in my book I talk about is that look at the history department in Kiev, in the major university in Western Ukraine, they don't teach anything but Ukrainian history because they're so desperate to build a sense of Ukrainian national identity at this moment. So it's not that that has gone away, but Western Europe and the United States have to a certain extent moved away from that. But as I said from my figures, really, not entirely. I mean, 40% of the people who teach history in the United States teach U.S. history. It's not like that's a small number, as we know from any history department that we've ever been in. So I don't think that's totally gone away, and I'm not even sure that it's a good idea for it to go away, because I'm not convinced that the nation state is gone as a kind of political structure, or that it would even be a good thing for it to be gone as a political structure. And if you don't have coherence, as we have seen, and a sense of belonging, you have big trouble that comes in its wake. So I'm not sure I think that has completely disappeared. In fact, I tried to argue that world history was big in the United States first precisely because of its immigrant population, in which there was an attempt to say, you belong, and we're all gonna find out about where you came from because we're all in this together. So I think it's actually a very complicated question and one that we need to be thinking more about, but that, as you know, the way we structure history education is a question we hardly ever discuss. Like, why are you doing this? What do you think it's about? What is its broader social purpose? What do you think is the meaning of this within a sort of the intellectual structure that we live in? Really, that's all I'm trying to do is say we should maybe talk about these things a little bit more because they seem actually very important. I don't think that the social history moves of the 1950s and the 1960s, which were at the time of the culture wars blamed for sort of denigrating the American narrative, I do not think they have had that impact. I think there's a greater interest in American history than ever before, as can be seen by the proliferation of museums, about aspects of American life that there were never museums about in the past, not just the history of slavery, but the history of all different kinds of peoples within the United States. So I don't think I think there's actually a huge interest in these kinds of interconnections, and it doesn't mean the end of history, and it doesn't mean that we have to find new patrons in that sense, because I think what we need to do is think more about, well, what is it that we're really advocating here? There's actually a tension about this in American history circles. Some of my closest friends and collaborators in American history don't like the connection to nation building, but I myself am a believer in it, probably because I study France, where nation building has always had such an incredibly important role, not just in history as a discipline, but sort of in the life of the nation altogether. And I just don't see that. So in that sense, I don't think deterritorialized capital markets has led to the decline of the nation state. I just don't think that's true. But it's the kind of thing that is hard to resolve with, you know, one empirical test or another. But I think it's worth thinking about because it has to do with how we imagine the world that we want to inhabit as historians and as scholars and as citizens. So I think this is all very important for the future of the country, our country, and all other countries.
And I'm afraid, keep taking a look at the clock, we've reached that point in the evening where conversations are best continued over wine and refreshments. But before we adjourn, please join me in thanking Lynn Hunt.